Bawadi, and I'll be acting, or I am your chair. We have with us members of the board. We have Councillor Ross Eady, who's also the councillor for the Minarski Ward. We have board members Barry Tuckett, Derek Johansson, Larry Richardson, and Mary Jane Mustel. We need to move leave of absence motions. Our executive director, Don Norquay, and member Alicia are away today. Could somebody move a...
I'll move a motion for...
Scarlett? Thank you. Thank you, Councillor Eady. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. We have staff with us here today. Mallory Richard is acting executive director. Sherwood Armbruster is our committee clerk. Of course, we have Chief Danny Smythe and members of the service with us here this morning. We have minutes to move from the meeting held November 4th, 2016. Somebody care to move those?
So moved.
Derek Johansson, all those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. All right. This morning's meeting will be dealing with both our regular agenda as well as dealing with the 2017 preliminary budgets. We'll start, I guess, with delegations. We have Andy Hutchinson, Program Coordinator of Kaadni Kamachikchiks Medicine Bear Counseling, Sport and Elder Services, and Leslie Spillett, Executive Director, Kaadni Kamachikchik, to be heard with respect to missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls in Canada. Winnipeg Police Service 2016 report. Good morning, ladies.
Good morning. Just start by talking about Kaadni Kamachikchik. So it's a Cree word, and it means those who go forward, those who lead. So we are a community-based organization here in Winnipeg. Very nice to be back sitting at this table. It's lovely to see everyone. I'm going to let my colleague Angie to speak on our behalf, because her portfolio or her file is with murdered and missing Indigenous women and girls. And so I'll let Angie take it over.
Good morning. Thank you. We come to the Winnipeg Police Board this morning on the morning of the National Day of Remembrance on Action on Violence Against Women to address the devalorizing manner in which Miss Angela Poorman was depicted in the WPS press conference on November 29, 2016. In this press conference, the Winnipeg Police expressed their commitment to Miss Poorman, her family, and loved ones. However, how can there be this level of commitment when at the same press conference they continue to perpetuate social norms of violence directed at Indigenous women and girls through their description as this being a very preventable incident, and that when individuals engage in this type of manner, in this high-risk lifestyle as they describe, anything can happen. The picture that was painted of Ms. Poorman was one of a sex trade worker whose actions led to the situation surrounding her death. The narrative the Winnipeg Police choose to frame an individual sets the context for which it is delivered in the media and discussed at the public at large. These words disregard Ms. Poorman, first and foremost, as a fellow human being who is loved by her family and deserving of respect in both life and death. And these details had no place in the announcement of the investigation. In 2016, the Winnipeg Police Board's plan lays out an objective to maintain and promote public confidence and trust in the Winnipeg Police Service. With these choice of words, these very powerful words used to describe Ms. Poorman, the Indigenous community was once again reminded of the strained relationship with the Winnipeg Police Service rather than one of confidence and trust. Instead of focusing on the work that the Winnipeg Police had been undertaking to investigate and charge an individual with this crime, it turned to how the Winnipeg Police portray Indigenous people, in particular Indigenous women. This same 2016 business plan also speaks to enhancing board awareness of and sensitivity to issues affecting safety and security of Indigenous people, with specific action items on how the board can contribute to a national inquiry on murdered and missing Indigenous women. We call upon the Winnipeg Police Board to see this use of language and the description of Indigenous women and girls as a specific area to focus on improving issues affecting the safety and security of Indigenous people. If the Indigenous community does not feel that they are valued at a very basic human sense, how will they feel safe and secure to turn to the Winnipeg Police? How will the families of murdered and missing Indigenous women and girls feel confidence and trust in the Winnipeg Police Service in how their loved ones' cases will be managed? While the Winnipeg Police has made efforts to build a stronger relationship of confidence and trust with the Indigenous community, it is still a fragile relationship. This relationship is even more precarious with families of murdered and missing Indigenous women and girls. Our hope is that you will take what you have heard here today and make conscious efforts to shift the narrative when depicting Indigenous women and girls in conversation, in media releases, and most importantly, in investigations as Indigenous women and girls move towards a relationship of respect and trust. Thank you.
We'd be happy to answer any questions, but I recall many times at this table, and some of my colleagues may also recall that, how one of my themes here is to really look at how do we shift that conversation. Because, you know, rather than the story being, a perpetrator was caught for a murder of Indigenous woman, really in our community we see, there we go again. There is the kind of the blame the victim mentality that is that we've seen, that we've had a history of, and that we've really been trying to interrupt and stop. You know, because, you know, we value our people, we value our women, and, you know, we don't think that what she did has anything to do with her murder. I mean, it's like it's kind of like the analogy of women are saying, you know, women are dressed in a particular way, that's why men rape them. That has nothing to do. We've debunked that mythology that women are somehow responsible for their own rape because they dress in a particular way. And so this is very similar, and this lines up in a very similar way. And I think that we once again are here at this table to try to shift that narrative. You know, I think it's deep in how we see things here. I think this is our old story. We got to start telling new stories to one another that our people are valuable, and especially on this day, December 6th in 1989, I believe, many years ago, Mark Lapine also had a particular narrative about women. And look at where that ended. And I don't think that there's much of a difference between those individuals that rape and murder our women have a similar narrative running through their brains, that our women are disposable, and therefore, you know, that is part of the reason for the very high, profoundly high numbers of missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls in this country. And so that is our presentation. And again, we'd invite you to ask us any questions.
Thank you very much, ladies. Councillor Eadie?
So this is like with your just a confirmed your. When we use this kind of language, we're desensitizing people to the real issue. I think that's what you're trying to tell us, right?
I guess what we're trying to say is when we use this language, it has an impact, and it's desensitizing, but it's victim blaming. Somehow she was responsible for her own murder because of the situation she found herself in. We don't know what her situation was, and yet we label it, and it lays blame at the individual level and not at the very broader social level.
I think societally the Lapine thing is kind of still there, and I think that's why we have our ceremonies all the time. But so I guess the more often if the police service started to use language that sensitizes people to the real issue, which is nobody has a right to kill anybody, we are all human beings, and the message is simply woman is wrong, and that builds up more of a sense of society to the issue.
Yeah, you know, and I think there's enough research. I know that a book was written about James Crawford asked why he went and hunted Indigenous women and girls, and his in his mind that people would not care about it. because we have had a history where our lives have been fundamentally devalued by the broader social community, by the culture of the community.
Besides how we react to these situations, have you had discussions about what can be done more proactively to try to ensure that society understands that these murders have nothing to do with what they're...
I think, Councillor, that's what we do almost every day, that we are engaged in this work here, and when we're just in community, is to talk about our families, like they have value, that they matter, that our lives matter, that Indigenous women matter, Indigenous lives matter. Of course, we talk about this all the time. Now, what I think we could do is to add, I don't know what kind of training that we have within our service with respect to this, but I think that we could maybe take a look at that and have women. I know that you do have training on Indigenous women, but just to, and I think, you know, maybe training is not enough. You know, maybe we have to kind of look at policy at policy level and look at our communications policies in terms of how this gets. You know, when we talk about these things, how do we communicate that as a Winnipeg Police Service?
Mr. Chair, if I could respond.
Sure, Chief.
So first of all, I want to acknowledge what you brought here today. I would agree that the language that was used in that press release certainly didn't. It probably hurt the family, and I acknowledge that, and acknowledge the message that you're bringing here. I would apologize specifically to the Poorman family for the dissensitive way that we portrayed that particular medium message. What I can tell you, though, is that we've begun to make changes, and you know, this is one case where you know, the language that was used I wasn't happy with. But if you start to look at even the report on the Indigenous women's safety, you'll start to see that our language and our tactics around have changed. We refer to the victims as exploited persons. We refer to those that are coming into the community to exploit as predators. That shift has begun. You know, this is an instance where I think we could have been more sensitive in this particular case. I can tell you that I spoke to the PIO office afterwards. I was aware of this long before today, you know, just reminded them to be more mindful of the language that is used in press releases. So I would hope this is more of a one-off that we're dealing with. I am certainly very sensitive to this issue and sensitive to the way we message it going forward. And I agree with your position on this, and you know, we will try to be more sensitive for all families going forward.
I agree. Things have changed. I mean, this is in working in this community with our family members for a very long time, and I agree that things have shifted somewhat. But this just kind of reminds us that there's still work to be done, that's the reason. Because it hurts the families. Absolutely hurts the families when they read this and how their loved ones are characterized. But I think it also hurts everybody. It's an image that we get stuck in our heads about who we are, and we need to shake that. This is people say almost 2017 now. We really have to shake that narrative of how we see Indigenous people and Indigenous women.
Agreed. And some of the things that we've done, certainly the establishment of our counter-exploitation unit and all of the outreach work that we do with the communities, I acknowledge we made a mistake in this instance, but I hope one mistake isn't going to take away all of the work that we've been trying to work with in the community and will continue to work.
Thank you very much. Okay. MJ?
Thank you. First of all, thank you very much to Gunaginichuk for doing the work that you do in the community. It's such important work, and it's not easy work. And thank you for coming today and drawing our attention to concerns that our Indigenous community has locally and on such a profound day, too. I mean, this meeting was rescheduled today, December 6th, and it is such a remarkable day for us to reflect upon the way in which social discourse continues to perpetuate victims as being responsible for their own demise when these kinds of incidences happen. It was in December of 2014 at this board meeting that we called for a resolution around missing and murdered women and set the course in collaboration, really, with the Winnipeg Police Service to try to do better across our city. And I really appreciate, Chief, your words today that this was something that has been discussed. It certainly isn't, in my opinion, a lifestyle choice when women are forced to make decisions such as those that Ms. Poorman had to make for herself and for her family. I would ask, and we have done this in the past, that we perhaps take a minute to honor our women and our society and to reflect upon women who have lost their lives to this social discourse that leaves women feeling less than valued, and honor perhaps those women and their families that were lost to Mark Levine's hands as well. If we could take a moment of silence for that, I would appreciate it.
Salute. Shauna Fontaine, co-chair of the Winnipeg Police Board Indigenous Council on Policing and Crime Prevention in Winnipeg, to be heard with respect to the use of force policy consultation draft. Good morning.
Good morning. It's a
Welcome.
Beautiful day outside.
Isn't it, though?
I just want to thank Leslie and Angie for speaking on that very important matter, because it's also one that at Southern Chiefs organization where I work when I'm not Indigenous Advisory Council, that we also echo that as I work in violence prevention and justice. But I'm here to talk about the use of force draft policy on behalf of the Indigenous Advisory Council. And I don't have a formal presentation. Really what I have is a list of questions for both the Winnipeg Police Board's kind of consideration in redrafting before it's finalized in January, and also a little bit of information to the Chief of Police in regards to the direction that was provided to the Chief of Police, and some input from the Indigenous Advisory Council in considering how does the Winnipeg Police Service offer their reports to the Police Board, and perhaps it can be the policy could be drafted in a way that reflects some of our recommendations. So now we are aware that the use of force policy is exactly that, use of force, and that there are other policies and ones to come forward in the future. But we do have a couple of questions in regards to being a little bit more specific as to what is use of force. Is it physical force that we're talking about? When is the use of force being applied? Is it while in police custody, while being detained? So we want to kind of get a little understanding there. Because we also see use of force as being verbal, emotional. Aggression can be construed as use of force to Indigenous peoples as well as other peoples, marginalized groups. We also want to ensure or find out, does the use of force policy include negligence, such as not providing the necessities to individuals, such as providing require life-saving protection and medications. We are aware there's instances where individuals are detained and are not being provided the emergency services that they might need at the hospital. So we want to ensure that that use of force is also being reflected in there. And we want to see that it's working in collaboration with the other policies, with the bias-free policing policy, as well as any future policies. In regards to the direction to the chief in the training section, we want to know what kind of cultural considerations are going to be provided in any kind of training. For example, for some Indigenous cultures, making eye contact is not... It's not part of the culture, and to a non-Indigenous culture that might be misconstrued as somebody being guilty or hiding something, when it's really actually just a sign of respect, and so we want to reflect that. We also want to know what kind of historical and contemporary contexts are provided that could help minimize the use of force, so knowledge of residential schools, for example, child welfare system. And what kind of cultural safe practices are considered or integrated into all training. We also want to know what best practices are going to be incorporated with working with children and youth. As we know that some children and youth come from homes that are impoverished, maybe they've already are experiencing violence or some sort of abuse within their homes. We also want to be aware of mental health situations of individuals, and then looking at how is the training going to reflect things such as developmental challenges of individuals, both youth and adults, FASD, autism, for example, ADHD, or intellectual disabilities. We also want to know how often is this training going to be provided to police officers. Is it ongoing? Is it a one-time thing? We want to kind of get an idea there, because we know that over time it needs to be refreshed. We also want to ensure that all training is following trauma-informed practices and vicarious trauma for the police officers as well. We hope that the training is also going to be covering things such as addictions and dealing with people in those aspects, and how to address those situations and address people with disabilities. In regards to crowd management, we want to know what kind of what will be done to minimize the trauma that children might experience if they're exposed to use of force in a public setting. And then in regards to accountability in the annual report, we know that evaluation and monitoring is only as good as the data collection. So what we've seen, or what we believe from the past, is that some things that are missing from the accountability and annual reports is the ability for recipients who have been subjected to use of force to have an opportunity to make a formal complaint. So we know that there are three complaint processes, the Professional Standards Unit, LIRA, and the IIU. We feel that there are barriers to reporting in all three instances, and the public is not aware of how to report in all those instances, and that prevents individuals from coming forward. We want to push for some sort of liaison, an Indigenous liaison person within the unit who can help support people in coming forward with complaints and concerns, as we know that the relationship between Indigenous peoples and policing has not been great. In regards to that as well, we know that some of those units do not fall under the police board. However, we would encourage the police board to push for some sort of system in which Indigenous peoples can come forward, that there is an outlet that they can come and speak to. We know that in the reporting, it's about the officer who's used the use of force to have to come forward and own up to that and speak to it. And we have a concern that maybe there wouldn't be that balance. If an officer does come forward, maybe the person who's use of force using them hasn't had an opportunity to speak to their experience, and it minimizes the impact for that particular individual. So we want to see the power imbalance shifted.
Shifted to equality,
but equity, really about, you know, it's a power imbalance at the current time, and so we want to be able to see that individuals who have been subject to use of force, whether that be physical or verbal, that they have an area to be able to report as well, so that can be captured in the Chief of Police's annual report. We also hope that the annual report can identify things such as race, age, sex, so that the police board can get a better understanding of who is use of force being used against more often, and this would also help to inform the bias-free policy to ensure that there is no bias created. That is all I have. So thank you very much. Those are some questions that you guys can consider in moving forward with the policy and in the direction to the chief.
I just want to start, Shauna, by saying thank you to you and the council. I was at the most recent meeting, and I think there's some very valuable feedback that will help shape this policy going forward. And thank you for the work and time you guys put in. So, were there any questions or comments? MJ?
Thank you. I'm wondering, Shauna, if you've submitted those questions to the office for consideration by Governance Committee when we're looking at the policy.
I will forward this list over to you.
Thank you, and I echo the appreciation of the consideration of the policy. I think it's important for us to reflect on the value of having a policy such as this, and it is about striking balance, the balance of safety of the public as well as the respect of individuals, and that any use of force should be justified in the circumstances that present. So we will certainly take a look at the feedback that you've provided. I'd encourage the public to continue to provide feedback on this policy. We have until Friday to receive feedback. I guess I would have a question of you in regard to the value of such a policy and whether or not it is something that you feel by this public expression, public-facing documentation of the policies in terms of the governance over the service itself adds value to the communications that might take place, whether it be across organizations that service Indigenous communities or amongst the Indigenous community, whether there's value in this and how you see we may be able to improve our communications around this type of policy.
I think that as we discussed at the Indigenous Advisory Council meeting, that these public requests are going out there to agencies, you know, for input, and I wish that more agencies would come forward and speak and send in their recommendations, and perhaps as part of the Indigenous Advisory Council, we can support those initiatives when coming forward with new policies in the future. So for now, we have, you know, 13 Indigenous Advisory Council members representing different organizations and community. So we are able to give some input into your processes in developing these policies. I just encourage the public to come forward and be able to speak on it, because it is a city matter that, you know, affects everybody. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, no other delegations. We'll go into presentations. Okay, so this is Mallory and Derek to we'll get the projector on here.
Yes, thank you.
Is the projector on?
Yeah.
Sherry, do you know how to turn on the projector?
Sure, you're on.
Turn it off. Oh, I got it.
Is it just taking a trip? Here we go. Okay.
Yeah, for sure.
Your wingman.
Yeah.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, fellow members of the board, the police service, it is our pleasure for the committee to present the 2017 budget estimates. This is the first time the current constituted committee has been able to put this forward. So I'm going to take you through a short presentation that will sort of outline what we've got in our estimates for 2017. First of all, I want to just remind everybody the budget preparation duties specifically stated in the Police Service Act that the board must provide council with an estimate of costs required to operate the police service in the next fiscal year. Council is responsible for establishing the total budget for the police service, and then the board is responsible for allocating the funds that are provided to the police service under the city budget. And then we're also governed by the Manitoba Police Commission policy, which states that the board must work with the police of the police chief to prepare estimates that align with the strategic plan. And the board has a legal duty to independently determine the budget that is sufficient to maintain an adequate and effective police service. So there are a number of things that the committee considered, and I want to took into consideration as we put forward this plan, so I want to go through those. First is the crime in Winnipeg has generally decreasing. There was a modest increase in crime in 2015, really across Canada. That also included Winnipeg. But the numbers as of October 31st has property crime down 6% versus 2015, and violent crime up 4%. Calls for service, have increased. As our population increases, we expect that to happen since 2008. But the most common, the top five calls for service, are non-criminal in nature. And they are domestic, check well-being, assistance, disturbance, and suspicious persons. I had the opportunity to, in fact, all the members of the board had the opportunity to go into the call center and just see the great work that those people are doing in identifying and dispatching our service. The other element is that Winnipeg's violent crime severity index is higher than national average, but we have narrowed that. So since 2009, we're narrowing the gap. Ideally, we'd like to be below the national average, but we're going in the right direction. Next one is calls for service. So again, you'll see the calls for service. Red is citizen-generated events, and the blue is police-initiated events. So it's important that we started this program, which is a fundamental part of the strategic plan, the proactive policing, where the police service will actually dispatch themselves to a particular opportunity to either engage with the public or engage on their own. And a fundamental part of that strategic plan is them having the time to really be in the community to prevent the amount of crime that's out there. The conclusion, though, that we have is that we have to remember is that the gross calls for service can be misleading, and that the issues and solutions are in the details to get the right resources to do the right task. And that's really what the committee will be working with the service the years to come, 2017 to start. Other considerations is the strategic plan. Police budget will increase at or less than the inflation rate. That's part of our strategic plan. The council's direction in 2016 to the board was to find $3.5 million in savings, and which created a new base. Therefore, that change, that reduction, is sort of carries through into the 2017 budget. Obviously, we are in the middle of a collective bargaining agreement. It's under negotiation. That will have the most significant impact on budgets going forward, given that the 83% of the budget is sort of represented in the elements of that negotiation. Other thing is that an example is that in 2016, in that year, we had a $3.5 increase based on a actuarial reevaluation of what the contribution needed to be to cover the pensions of the police service. So $3.5 million, wasn't in the original adopted budget, and of course that's now a number that gets carried forward into 17, 18, and for the years to come. Also in consideration is the importance of the initiative of proactive policing. you know, we want to tackle the root causes. In doing that with partnership, there's a tremendous program that the service is doing called the Alliance Project, where they're working with different stakeholders to try to get down to, you know, again, the root cause of some crime and find innovative solutions to be able to reduce it. We're promoting efficiency is another element that we're looking at as we go into it. We have a beautiful new head office or headquarters, and we're looking for ways to find efficiencies. The board in 2017 will be setting targets to save and enhance the quality of service through innovation. Long-term plans is, you know, to get need less resources on a per capita basis. The plan to better handle repeat offenders, missing kids, kids repeatedly running away from care. You know, we have in our in one of the reports here that 27 individuals in the last quarter went missing 15 or more times. So a tremendous amount of resources are being used on a relatively small percentage of the people. That's a real indication that there's a better solution, that we need a different solution than what we're doing now. And so that's what the service is looking to in the future, is, you know, how we can handle some of these repeat situations from repeating. There is our final forecast, our estimates, total operating cost of $288 million, estimated revenue $47 million. So there certainly has been a significant investment in the police force over the last 4 years, over 17%. Our target, as previously described, is an increase of 1.28. Both 18 and 19 right now are projected to be over what is the board's goal of inflation. So there's still some work to be done on those fronts. Expenditure increases were due to an increased cost in salary, benefits, accommodations. And when you get a brand new building, it comes with a whole bunch of other costs associated with it. So $4.16 million on permanent salaries and $4.23 million more than the 2016 adopted budget because of the pensions, as I shared, the actuarial recalculation. And then $1.3 million more for accommodations in the new headquarters. Aside from accommodations, the overall rate of non-salary increases is less than inflation. And that is achieved primarily through deferral. So there's $4.2 million worth of capital that has been deferred. And it's just important to note that, you know, when we do deferrals, we are putting down the street an issue that we're going to eventually have to deal with, but it also gives us this opportunity of more time to figure out what are the innovations and changes we can make to make up for that. Estimated $1.25 million less in photo radar, which really should be good. You know, it's bad news for the budget, but it's good news if photo enforcement is working. We want that number to go down. Here's the capital projects. Case management system was originally in the budget in 2016, was turned from cash to capital due to a shortfall that or an unanticipated higher cost of salaries than we had anticipated, due primarily to less people retiring than we had budgeted for. But we have brought that back into the 2017. It is one of the major measurable improvements that is in the strategic plan that the service is working through on in their business plan. Then we have the IT upgrades and the division system upgrade and the North End station. So what is the outlook? The outlook is continued trend to raising calls for services likely. Increase in debt and financing. It is important to remember every time we spend in capital that it's not just that capital, but there is a residual cost associated generally with that. So we're now sitting at, you know, 15 cents of every dollar going to debt and finance charges, 12% to accommodation costs, and that this cost, the capital transition, is something that we have to be very conscious of as we move forward into 18 and 19. Outcomes of the collective bargaining negotiation will have a big impact on our future budgets. And the anticipated rate of retirements, we're anticipating them increasing, but we are budgeting fewer retirements per year. This year we end up 20% less people retired than what we had anticipated, so we want to be on the conservative side. I guess everybody loves the new head office. That's a good sign, so they're not retiring. So that is the report from the Budget and Finance Committee. There is a resolution in your package that, if I could, with a lot of whereases, here we go. So we can hand out a copy if you'd like. So this is the recommended estimates for the Winnipeg Police Service 2017 operating capital budget.
Board members all have copies in their binders. Those were
so I'm going to move to the therefore, be it resolved, one, that the board provide council with an estimate of $288,280,000 as the total operating cost of the Winnipeg Police Service in 2017 that are required to maintain an adequate and effective police service in Winnipeg. Two, that the board advise council that its estimate, the net mill rate support required for the Winnipeg Police Service in 2017 is $240,876,709 based on a revenue estimate of $47,103,571. Three, that the board provide council with an estimate of $23,585 as the total cost for capital projects for the Winnipeg Police Service in 2017. That are required to maintain an adequate and effective police service in Winnipeg, and four, that the board recommend to council that it approve the preliminary 2017 operating budget and financial plan for 2018 and 2019, and the preliminary 2017 capital budget and the 2018 to 2022 five-year forecast as they pertain to the Winnipeg Police Service as tabled by the Executive Policy Committee.
Okay.
I shall move.
So moved. Thank you. Any further discussion on the budget? I'll just make the comment, I suppose, then, that obviously there's all sorts of pressures when it comes to the cost of policing in our city. I know the police board prior to me has spent a lot of work on the strategic plan, and you know, the reality that we've been able to get the number down is, I think, a lot of testament to both the service and to the members of the police board. So I will be supporting the motion from the subcommittee chair, Johansson. Any further comments? Okay, we'll call the question then. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Thank you very much, everyone. All right, so we'll move into regular reports. As published on the agenda, there's the chair's report. It was an honor to attend the graduation of recruit class 149 and 149, 159 and 159L. That was very interesting. It was great to attend the Indigenous Council's meeting, and a lot of good people doing a lot of good work on that committee. And just orientation, I've been meeting with all sorts of good folks. Met with the Manitoba Police Commission representative, as well as I was in Ottawa recently for Federation of Canadian Municipality Advocacy and Board Meeting Days, and met with representatives of the Canadian Association of Police Governments, CAPG, there. So My report is in your packet. If somebody would care to move it for me. Thanks, Barry. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. We now have a report from our chief. Good morning, Danny.
Good morning. Of course, I've submitted my monthly report. I'd just like the opportunity to highlight just a few of the events within the past reporting period. I guess first and foremost, since taking the role of chief, I've filled essentially two vacancies at the executive management team. So I'd like to take the opportunity to introduce all of you to Deputy Chief Jeff Siskowski sitting to my left. Jeff was the superintendent that oversaw investigations, certainly has been my right-hand man through much of the last few years, helping me manage the investigations portfolio. Jeff comes to us with nearly 25 years service and most recently the superintendent of our investigations. Certainly before that he had division command experience in both major crime and our professional standards unit. But if you look at his resume, you'll find he's pretty well-rounded through uniform, tactical, and a number of areas, HR and training. So I'm very pleased to welcome him up to the executive and to introduce him to you. He was promoted on November 9th, the day after my swearing in. 1 week later, we promoted Inspector Rich Lowen to superintendent. He's not here this morning, but he essentially will fill Jeff's vacancy. Rich is also about 28 years experience, pretty well-rounded experience, most recently as the inspector of our major crimes, and again before that, professional standards. So happy to have them both at the executive level and looking forward to a continued relationship with the board. Just like to acknowledge the graduations that have occurred in the last reporting period. As mentioned by Mr. Chair there, we had a graduation of 37 recruits that are now deployed into the field. And we also had a cadet class graduate in the last reporting period as well. We had 14 cadets graduate on November 3rd. Both classes are representing the diversity of our unit, of our city well. So I'm pleased with the recruitment efforts on both the cadet and the police level. The other thing I wanted to highlight was the Innovation Committee. The City of Winnipeg, of course, has the Innovation Committee. They selected one of the initiatives from the police service on the alarm permit renewal initiative. That proposal was brought forward by one of our business analysts in IT. We've received essentially a $30,000 grant from the Innovation Committee to really move forward and determine how best to upgrade and modernize our alarm permit renewal system. It's a good service to the citizens. It's also one that generates revenue for us as well, but it's certainly in need of an upgrade, and kudos to our business analysts for bringing forward that one. Probably the last one I want to highlight is just our response to the emergence and the continued emergence of fentanyl and our planning and awareness around that. Certainly the service has been working hard to deal with this increased emergence. Certainly fentanyl has been in our city for a number of years, but we are certainly becoming more aware of the insidious outcomes of much of the fentanyl use. Our efforts have focused on primarily two areas, raising public awareness around the dangers of fentanyl and other opioids, but also a great deal of effort in educating and equipping our members to safely deal with opioids when they are encountered in the field. So to that end, I've asked Inspector Max Waddell to attend this morning. Many of you have met Max before. He is the division commander of our organized crime unit, but he's also taken the lead in much of our response around fentanyl, and I've asked him just to provide you with a short overview of what we have been involved in the last year, frankly.
Yeah? Good morning.
Okay, good morning, everyone. I'd like to start off by acknowledging that there were a couple board members at our most recent training. Mr. Tuckett and Ms. Zakarwich, if I pronounce that correctly, both attended, so I hope you found it informative and you took away some good knowledge. I think in order to properly understand and investigate this epidemic as we see it is we have to understand really what fentanyl is. Fentanyl is a synthetic opioid that is man-made in labs that requires many precursors to put together. As we know it, usually doctors use it as a pain medication, as a sedative, and when used in safe ways, it can be very productive. In the chain of analogs, we all know what morphine is, then that blends into what fentanyl is, so fentanyl is about 100 times stronger than morphine, to put it in perspective. Then we have a new drug in the street called carfentanil, and that is then 100 times stronger than fentanyl. That's a drug used by veterinarians to sedate elephants, and at 2 milligrams, which is 2 granulars of salt, can be lethal. So when exposed to that, we have to be very careful how we handle that. In illicit forms on the street, we're seeing it in various forms, from patch to pill to liquid to paste to blotter form. And the most concerning is when it's in powder form, because then it can be inhaled. There are many dangers associated around it. Medically, we measure it in micrograms, again, because it's such a small amount. We're seeing pure fentanyl in illicit drugs such as cocaine and heroin. So for a simple drug user, they don't necessarily know what they're getting, and that's why we're seeing a lot of overdoses. There are no field tests for police officers to actually check to see what they're dealing with on the street, so they have to send it away to Health Canada each and every time, which is a big change for us from cocaine investigations, etc. And we know that overdoses can lead to stopped breathing and cardiac arrest very quickly when you are exposed. Other dangers include you can absorb it through unbroken skin if, again, you inhaled it or you ingested it. The real concern is around our mucous membranes, around our mouth and our nose where there's capillaries. If you just get it on your skin, unless it becomes aqueous, which means putting water with it, you really don't need to be that concerned. It would take a long time for exposure to happen, but if it was mixed with water, it could become very dangerous. And typical signs and symptoms of fentanyl is it's a major disruptor of the nervous system. You become drowsy, you could have nausea, vomiting, and of course your eyes, your pupils will become very pinpointed, and you would eventually go into respiratory distress. It's a depressant, so again, your heart rate slows down, you'll slowly stop breathing, and then, of course, when you go into cardiac arrest, could be lethal. As the chief indicated, fentanyl has been around for a number of years, but just not in the illicit form that you see it today. And I would best describe the current situation as changing in the fall of this year, when our police officers made a seizure at a hotel in the west end of the city. It was actually September the 12th, where they came across 1,477 blotter tabs of an unknown substance and a small amount of powder. Upon sending that away to Health Canada, it came back tested for the drug carfentanil. As I explained, the drug 100 times stronger than fentanyl and can be extremely lethal. So for myself in organized crime, I was assigned to assist with this response to that, and that's when we really knew that we had a problem here. And in fact, that was the first time in Canada that carfentanil was found in blotter form. So we were taking a number of calls all across Canada, trying to understand better what was going on with this new product. We know it's here. We know it's being distributed. Quite simply, it can be ordered online from China. Within 48 hours, you can have it to your door. There's many, many websites online. If you don't receive your package, they're so good, they'll send you another one. It's guaranteed delivery. And it's from that point on, the powder, what they do with it, how they mix it, that it can become lethal. One of the doctors that are training, I think, used the best analogy that we all know what chocolate chip cookies are, and perhaps our parents or grandparents made chocolate chip cookies. Well, not every cookie has the same amount of chocolate chips in it. So if you were to take a cookie and have two chocolate chips on it, that can be quite safe. But if you were to ever get that cookie that maybe had 8 or 10 and that was the opioid in there, that can become lethal. So when they're making and mixing this stuff, there's hot spots in it. It's not a science. You got to remember it's made illicitly. It's made in garages. It's made in backyards. It's made in tents. And they're not the most proficient at this. Why have we seen this shift from cocaine and heroin to fentanyl? Quite simply, it's all about profitability. The amount of money that these individuals are making this, it's astounding. And they've tapped into this niche to generate higher profits. there's really not one unit that is not impacted by fentanyl in our service. And that goes from tactical support to uniform operations to our drug processors, who at the end of the day, when we make these seizures, they have to safely now take this drug. They have to take a small sample from it and send it away. So we have to make sure that those conditions are safe for them. We're working on that, getting the proper equipment in place to do that. It really goes on and on. I could talk to great length about that in itself. And really, what is our response to the fentanyl crisis? Is it's a simultaneous, multifaceted approach. First thing we did was we created a fentanyl mitigation working group. I chair the group. We meet weekly. That's all the stakeholders within the service, where we get together and we discuss all the issues and collectively try and come up with new policies and procedures that we need to implement to first and foremost make our members safe. So that's a number of experts throughout the service, again, that we meet, and we've examined best practices across Canada. Really, Vancouver has had this exposure since 2010. The RCMP, I would say, are the leaders right now, although I'd like to say we're a close second, because we've really come a long way in a short amount of time, but we've taken a lot of our direction from the RCMP. We've educated the membership through many forms, from training sessions to on our PoliceNet, which is a medium we use for all different types of media. We've created exhibit and safe handling guidelines to properly show our members, in the event that they were put in a situation, how to protect themselves. That includes the use of an N95 mask, which is an approved mask for the situation. They have to all wear two sets of gloves, not one set. You have to use double nitrile gloves. And we always want their arms covered. Even with respect to planned investigations, it includes search warrants and undercover operations. We've had to change our protocols around that. And a challenge right now we're having is, how do you store and get rid of this waste? A number of the companies out there, such as Miller Environmental, they don't even have solutions for us right now on how to properly dispose of this due to the toxicity of this product. From there, we've worked very diligently on coming to a reversal medication known as naloxone, which is a reversal medication, providing training and distribution. We've had to increase the size of our clandestine lab members, which is a part-time unit. They're the ones that get dispatched to calls where there are large amounts of powder present and would not be suitable for uniform operations members to deal with. And then, of course, occupational health and safety is overseeing all this response, making sure that it's correct. Speaking about naloxone, with the assistance of Dr. Rob Grierson, who is the Winnipeg Fire Paramedic Service Medical Director, and Tashi Pharmacy, we've come up with our own in-house antidote that allows us to better control the dosages as we move forward. Again, it's a reversal medication to reverse the effects of opioids. The best way I can describe it is I'm sure there's a number of golfers in the room. The receptors in your brain that allow you to breathe look like a golf tee. There's nothing at the top of the receptor. And when you ingest an opioid, it's like the golf ball that goes and sits right on top of the golf tee. When you take naloxone, which is the only reversal medication, it goes in through the nasal capillaries, goes into your bloodstream, and it actually knocks that golf ball off the top of the golf tee, and that allows you to breathe again. So it's quite ingenious. We have to be very thankful for this. Without it, I don't know what would be used, but what I do know is in British Columbia, up until the end of October, they've had 622 fentanyl overdose deaths, which is again, an astonishing number. We're most certainly not here yet, but if you ever see some of these shows, such as in CBC, and that you see police officers walking around giving the antidote to people who look like they are lifeless, and within minutes of taking this, they actually stand up and walk away, because that's how fast-acting this drug is. It's really what I would consider a miracle drug. We've chosen to use the nasal spray to combat this versus needles. There's a lot of challenges around needles, especially with Winnipeg, winter conditions, a lot of exterior clothing, etc. A lot of people are protected. Much more difficult to administer. Plus, with a nasal spray, it's much easier for officers to administrate. We have to be careful, as it is temperature sensitive, so we have some protocols in place with an indicator in our kit to make sure that it's within the realms of the 15 to 25 degree mark and has a shelf life, we do believe, up to a year to 18 months. Also important to note that there are no adverse effects on people who are not taking opioids. So it's a benign product, meaning if you were to give naloxone to someone who was not in an opioid crisis, you wouldn't do harm to them and or yourself. So if we inadvertently get naloxone on us, that would not do any harm to one. And we have taken on, I guess, a bit larger role with respect to the naloxone, as the chief had indicated. We're actually assisting in a provincial response. So we're going to be the flow-through agency for all naloxone kits in the province. So we've worked, again, closely with the medical professionals and Tashi Pharmacy, and we're going to control that distribution as well as assist in training. So to that note, I'll talk about the two training dates we've held, one on November the 18th and the most recent on December 2nd, where we've put through approximately 1,100 people, not all police officers. There were superintendents from school divisions there. There was other educators, Canada Border Service, RCMP, a lot of rural law enforcement agencies. And we went through, I guess, a number of different training scenarios, starting with our clandestine lab members showing specific scenarios that we normally go through about in residences and dealing with vehicles, if you come across different powders and the processes and protocols you should use. We had Dr. Sherry Fondry, who is the Addictions Foundations of Manitoba doctor. And again, she explained that opiate path that I talked to you about how the antidote works and concerns that we should have. We had Dr. Rob Grierson attend, who demonstrated the proper use of the kits. It's really quite simple. You just take the kit out of the protective thing, you screw on an atomizer, and you just deploy it in either nostril of the affected individual. And it's the misting of the naloxone itself, which is at 4 milligram strength and 0.3 mLs, that will hopefully save someone's life. We have anecdotally heard from our fire paramedic people that more than one dose are often required on the street right now due to the strengths of drugs. For instance, if you were exposed to carfentanil, you could have to get, I think the average you said was about 3.5 doses per individual. So we have to be prepared for that. We also talked with federal prosecutions about the challenges around investigations around fentanyl, about it coming through the mail. And also we had our experts, our drug experts, regarding trafficking, about how drug dealers are using this and profiting from it and what we need to do as a police service to suppress that. And then lastly, we ended the day off with safe handling procedures and personal protective equipment. So we explained to the officers how to properly don a mask, the proper protection equipment you need to use, again, what scenarios you should be in. We categorize it in a low, medium, and high risk, and most certainly when there is a high-risk situation, we don't want our unprotected officers going into those, so we're doing our best to make that as clear as we can. There were also members from the community that also attended. There was an individual from IRCOM, from the Immigrant Refugee Communities Organization, who attended, and they will make sure that our newest community members are also up to speed, as sometimes, unfortunately, they are vulnerable to the drug scene. So at that point, I know time is limited. I would like to end what I've told you today, but if anyone has any questions, I would most certainly try my best to answer them.
Okay. Got a couple people here. We'll start with Councillor Eadie.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, just a quick question. So this is really concerning. If I'm sweating, that's water. So if I got this stuff on my skin and I'm sweaty, it's 32 Celsius, 33 Celsius. Is that enough moisture to activate and for it to get into your skin?
While I'm not a doctor, my understanding is that any amount of water would most certainly increase the susceptibility of you to become have an adverse effect. I would like to state, though, that it is just not a matter of that going into your skin and you're going to immediately drop. There is a period of time. But again, based on the strength of what that opiate is, would dictate the absorption rate. It also depends where you get it on you. In the body, there are certain areas that have thicker skin than others. The hand area does have actually quite a thick area, so I would think that it would be delayed, but you are absolutely right. That could increase your likelihood to absorption.
And just one other question. Is the federal lab still over here on Pioneer Water and Main Street? Or?
Unfortunately, we lost that lab a couple years ago, so we have to send all of our stuff out to Burnaby, although I will say that Health Canada has been... and still remains a great partner. They just recently sent a chemist out to give us all an education seminar recently. So we keep in close contact with those folks. And whenever there's a pressing matter, they're doing a great job in helping us better understand and give us results that we need to, end investigations and assist us to move forward.
Just a quick comment. First of all, I did find that session to be very informative. The numbers are staggering. The dangers are... It's very important, I think, that people do understand the dangers. But what I was quite impressed with was the, how many people were involved and how critical it really becomes that service themselves you know, the awareness, the training session that you put on to make it very clear, the awareness of the dangers and the safety, all the steps that are being taken to ensure the safety of the service itself. Thought that was really very well done, and I just wanted to comment on that. And it was certainly enlightening for myself. And another thing, just from a budget perspective, I was, you know, we heard about how much these doses were going to cost. It's really, you found the solution that really brings the cost down quite a bit as well. Not that that should be the main factor, of course.
No.
But I just wanted to comment on that. There are only 20, what was it? Started about 100 and went down to?
Well, the over-the-counter is about $73 plus tax, and we're in around the $20 mark.
Mm-hmm.
Again, as you indicated, it's not all about cost, but more so about that we now have the ability to control the dosing. Because as we see the drugs increase, we can then add and increase the milligram strength of the naloxone to better combat and reverse the opioid effect.
Yeah. And that's all I wanted to comment on, how critical it is about officer awareness and like the service awareness and safety factors.
Yeah. Well, thank you for that.
Thank you very much. And looks like there's a lot of important work going on. Oh, sorry, MJ?
Yeah. I too wanted to just comment on the cost, because while that was, it's really great to be able to minimize the cost like that, it is these types of incidences and the impact on the environment for policing that cause us to concern ourselves about the adequacy of resources available for policing. And while we just approved a budget that we set, it doesn't take into account the types of experiences that we as a society have when these types of when these types of things creep into our communities. I call it social disorder, and of course we try to work through public policy to set order, or what is agreed to be order amongst us citizens. We set up rules and bylaws and legislation, and then we ask the police to assist us in terms of managing that. But when you look at this, I did read that it was concerned to be either epidemic or could be epidemic. I also recognize that it's not just people that are after this type of drug, that this type of drug might be introduced even to children who are children, young people who are out celebrating and come across something like this, that there's a high need of awareness. And that even at that, in the way that we've experienced, even awareness that there's something out there that you should be concerned about doesn't seem to prevent some people from exploring these things. So I, first of all, I guess I want to thank you for the work that you've done. You did mention that there is a collaborative approach to accessing and distributing the kits that are required, but I'm wondering whether there's been any further public converse or public policy or conversation on the public response and what the overall system is doing, because this just doesn't involve the service of policing. It involves obviously the health profession as well. But I would imagine as well there's some conversation that should occur around justice, because people are dying from the infusion of this into society. And it is all, while there, you talk about it from the standpoint of drugs and there are drug laws, this is, and someone had asked me, isn't this like murder when you're actually giving somebody a dose of something that could kill them and indeed has? And so I'm wondering what public policy conversation there has that has occurred, and perhaps that's a question that Chief Smith would want to respond to.
So a couple of things there. Of course, this is not a police problem, but we have a role to play within it. I would characterize this as more of a health problem. Certainly there's been a lot of ongoing consultation with provincial officials. You'll note that they commenced with their public campaign last week as well, that John Lane and I participated in that campaign, just to further raise awareness. So lots of discussion going on with provincial officials at both the health side of the house and at the justice side of the house. So clearly this is a community problem that we have a role within. As you pointed out, you know, you do a quick environmental scan. This isn't something that we budgeted for. But it will impact us in 17, I suspect. One of the things that we're learning as our members encounter this stuff into the field, and one of the things we're training them to do, slow down. We don't want people making mistakes that could be costly to them or people that they're dealing with in the field. By slowing down, it's going to have an impact, a ripple effect through our calls for service. So I would expect that we will see an impact. Two things that we're doing there, we will introduce our fentanyl strategy as part of our business plan, which will include our ability to track the resources that get caught up in this response. And then, you know, it is something that we will then be able to report on through the quarterly business report for them.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Matt.
Okay. Anything else from your report, Chief?
No, that would conclude the highlights that I wanted to bring forward today.
Okay. Number three, missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls in Canada. Sorry? Oh, sorry. We need to have a motion to receive that report. Somebody? Vice Chair Tuckett, thank you. All's in favor? Opposed? Aye. Carried. Sorry, moving on to report number three, missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls in Canada, Winnipeg Police Service third quarter report.
Good morning on this one as well. I'm going to invite Inspector Dennison to come up just so you can, again, put a face to some of the people working in the behind the scenes. Inspector Dennison is the inspector of our Specialized Investigations Division. So the main unit that's engaged in this strategy is our Counter-Exploitation Unit. So I think what I'll do here is just highlight a couple of things from the report. Certainly, if there's any questions, I think Kelly is probably in the best position to provide some clarity around some of the issues. Certainly, our approach here has been to try to give you an overview of what we've been involved in, both at the investigation level, enforcement, prevention and intervention, community engagement, and, of course, research. So I'd like to highlight on the enforcement side what one of the trends that we've been seeing for a while, and certainly one of the challenges for Kelly's people, is just the way the sex trade in general is shifting. So we have always had sort of women that have been exploited on the front line in the streets, but we're seeing that shift now where technology is impacting, and a lot more of that is taking place using things like the internet to websites like Backpages and other sites like that where these engagements are occurring indoors, often in hotels, or being facilitated by some of the exploiters and women that are being exploited. So that's certainly been a challenge for the counter-exploitation team, just to try to balance their approach to having people on the street, but also focus some attention to some of the internet facilitated engagement. One of the other things that I wanted to highlight in the community engagement section is we were, you know, was responsible for arresting about 37 individuals in this past quarter that were engaged in exploitation activity. One of the things that we're also involved in, often many of the men, and primarily our men that are arrested, they're often diverted from the criminal justice system. It's often referred to as John School. That's facilitated by the Salvation Army. But certainly our counter-exploitation people play a role within that John School. We helped facilitate a John School initiative in this last quarter as well. And then I guess the last thing I want to highlight is just a research project. We have partnered with the University of Manitoba Victim Services volunteer who's completing her degree in social work, looking for a practicum or placement. So we have arranged for a practicum with her to partner with our counter-exploitation unit to give her some exposure into the field around this. So those are the three things I wanted to highlight from the report. I know Kelly is here to provide you with any more clarity should you have any other questions.
Thank you very much. Any questions? Okay, so everyone, I'm going to remove this report as information.
So moved.
Thank you, Derek. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Our executive director is not with us today, but we have
Thank you, sir.
Well done.
Thank you.
We have Mallory Richard as our acting chair today, our director, sorry.
He's the same person.
I'll keep my report brief because it is on the agenda, and so much of what board staff do is in support of work being done by the committees. So I will say briefly that we have been working on policy development, preparing materials for review by the governance committee. It's still a working title, but we're working on a policy on policing ethics and values. And the idea behind that policy is that when we were working with members of the services organizational and development support division, we all noticed that many of the values and principles for each of the policies we're envisioning down the line have a lot in common, and that there would be something to be said for having one policy that pulls those together. We've been working to support the board as it develops its formal budget estimates that were approved today. We've also been working on the board effectiveness evaluation. The evaluation itself is being done by the Office of the Chief Performance Officer, but when they have follow-up questions or they're looking for clarification, they've been contacting board staff for that.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mallory. Somebody prepared to move for report of information? Any questions? Carried. Thanks. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Number six, report from the governance subcommittee.
From budget and finance, or is it governance?
Oh, did I miss one? I missed one. My apologies.
Thank you.
We'll go back to five. Report from budget and finance subcommittee. Derek.
I'll just mention a couple of highlights. You know, we are continuing to monitor, work with the service on, better understanding the overtime, where there may be opportunities to address some of that. We're also looking at opportunities to actually set some innovation targets. We were involved in a presentation done by the CPAC that the Ottawa service had done some very innovative things, and some of the people in our service are familiar with those people. They said very significant, and it's one of those you need to invest money now to get a real bang for our buck in the future, and they're actually tallying over the last 4 years $9 million worth of savings through some very innovative approaches. So, going forward, this committee will be continuing to work with the service to figure out what could be some goals or targets that we could set that would not only create a more efficient and effective service, but also bring some money to be able to, really, it's about finding money to be able to put the money and the resources in the areas that we think are going to give us the best value for the citizens of Winnipeg.
Perfect. I mean, the more we can measure, the more we can report, the more we can get a handle of the cost drivers and the overtime, the better. So no, I appreciate that very much. And I know the new chief is certainly on side with that. So. Yeah. Great. Somebody prepared to remove the finance report?
He's moving it.
Oh, he moved it.
He's
okay, right. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Governance subcommittee.
Thank you. My committee report is also shared on the system. I guess of note, we've certainly talked about the fact that the use of force policy is currently under development and in for at this point in time for public review. But there are several other policies. I just want to echo Mallory's point that ethics and core values is also a very important policy that we're developing. In many of the situations dealing with policing, we rely on the good judgment of the officers to be able to evaluate the situation that they're dealing with, the risks that are present, and to apply the appropriate effort. So these policies guide that thinking, and I think are very important in that, and I believe the ethics and core values one will certainly go a long way towards speaking about the underlying and the fundamental values that we have as we're deploying our services. It mentions in the report that the meeting itself was abbreviated, and that was in light of the fact that we had a risk management meeting that morning, risk management audit committee, and there were many items that were on the risk management audit committee that talked about the systems that are in play within the Winnipeg Police Service to evaluate the risks that are presented in the environment for policing. And so we spent considerable time actually considering those elements. I think it's important to note that when you're looking at policy development, policies come in response to the evaluation of risk and in connection to the strategic planning, the direction, the values, the expectations in which we're going. They're also very connected back to the activity and the operations. So we spent some time collaborating. There is an overlap of the membership between risk management and the governance committee. So with that, I guess I would just close that to note that we're working on our 2017 business plan, which really is a collaboration between the committee work and the work of the office itself. And we should see that business plan coming forward.
Thank you so much, Mary Jane. Any comment or question? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Moving on to a report from the Risk Management and Audit Committee.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Well, the Risk Management Audit Committee, as we know, assesses the Winnipeg Police Service's risk management framework and its annual audits. I'll just give a brief summary of the one item we did. First of all, I wanted to say that to make it clear, the service does identify and assess its risk management plan on continually, and it looks at its mitigation strategies, and it informs the board on a regular basis. The committee met on November 18th to review items that had been deferred at its last meeting. Its primary objective was to receive an update from the Winnipeg Police Service on its risk management activities. The service's audit and accreditation supervisor provided the committee with an update on how the service categorizes, tracks, and monitors its risks. The committee received a general update on emerging risks and risks whose priority level had increased or decreased over the last year. And finally, the audit and accreditation supervisor informed the committee that the service had successfully delivered all 717 proofs it must send to the Commission on the Accreditation of Law Enforcement Agencies, which is CALEA, each year in order for the service to maintain its accreditation. I think that's the highlight of it, and that would be my report.
Yeah. Very good. Any further comments or questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Aye. Number 8, Winnipeg Police Service 2016 third quarter financial report.
Just present the report as presented, highlighting the continued forecast of photo radar coming in lower than budget, although there was an uptick in September that's not reflected in here in October. So there may be some positive news on that from a budgeting standpoint as we hit the end of the year with only really 3 weeks left in the year. It's interesting information, but the proof is really in the pudding in the next 4 weeks. But the anticipation of the committee and the service is that we will come in on budget on the expense side of our commitment to the citizens of Winnipeg.
Perfect. Very good. Any comment or question? All in favor? Opposed? Right. Carried. Number 9, Winnipeg Police Board 2016 third quarter budget update.
Again, it's the budget is as presented. As you can see, the board is so well within the budget that's been struck forward and was passed by committee, and I bring forward to the full board to get approval.
Okay. So moved. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Number 10, Winnipeg Police Service 2016 third quarter business plan update.
So on that one, we've submitted our report. As been our practice, we've sort of framed how we were going to try to report on many of the different action and objective items within the business plan. In the third quarter, there are five. I thought today what I would do is maybe just take 5 minutes here. You've heard us talk about STAR, our strategic tracking and reporting processes. What we do there is assign leads within senior management to take responsibility for many of the actions outlined in the strategic plan and ultimately the business plan. One of the actions for third quarter that we report on is to enhance our gang suppression strategy. I've capitalized on the fact that I do have Max here as well, and Max is the lead on that. I thought I'd just give you a sense of how we as an executive stay on top of many of the initiatives. So what ends up happening with STAR is that on a cyclical basis, our leads come forward and have to report on what's happened in the last 90 days, what they expect to happen in the next 90 days, and it gives the executive an opportunity to prioritize and stay on top of some of the strategic issues. So for this morning, just an abbreviated overview of what's happening with the gang suppression, and you'll get a sense of how the executive is staying on top of many of the business plan and strategic issues. So, not to put you on the spot again, Max, but if you want to just kind of walk them through some of the initiatives you've been involved in with the gang suppression strategy.
Okay, well, first and foremost, our strategy is built on four pillars. One being suppression, two being prevention, third being intervention, and lastly, education. So everything we do has to, in essence, align with those four pillars. So one of the actions was to align our suppression strategy with SPI. We all know what SPI is, the Smart Policing Initiative with Uniform Operations. We want to make sure that we're working in I guess, synchro with them. A lot of the action we take is information that is driven by SPI to make sure that when we're deploying our organized crime or street crime resources, that we're deploying them in an efficient and an intelligent-led manner. So, for instance, if there was a problem in a neighborhood surrounding gang activity, we would want to make sure that that was done in coordination with SPI. I guess one of the most important ones is around the prevention side of the strategy, where we have a program called GRASP. That's the Gang Response and Suppression Plan. That's where we monitor the top 100 offenders. So within our street crime unit, we continually keep on top of the compliance work with those individuals, make sure they're complying with their conditions, and that is measured, as the chief indicated, quarterly. That's often dependent upon the other workloads we have, but we always do our utmost best to ensure that those compliance checks are done. And I think the most important is engaging our youth and their families with early intervention to prevent gang recruitment. For myself, I've been on the job for 23 years now. It's like a cartoon. I keep going by the same tree here where we keep arresting. We're really trying to make a concentrated effort to reach out to the young siblings who are involved in families that have gang membership in them, meet those individuals, and then direct them to the appropriate social service resource out there to try and give them opportunities outside that of a lifestyle of being part of gangs. And so every time our units come in contact with these youth, we hook them up with the appropriate agency. We do a lot of close work with the provincial government, the crime prevention branch there especially. They have the Turnabout program. That's for individuals under the age of 12, where these individuals from the province will actually go meet with the family. They sit down with them. They say, what are the concerns? What are your challenges? You know, perhaps it's employment, or it's just after-school care, or getting them engaged in different sports activities. And we track all that. So the statistics simply on that up until the third quarter was, as we had met with where we had identified 51 kids, and of that, 30 wished to enroll in the program. We did have 21 that just said, no, thank you, we're fine. I mean, we can do our best to offer assistance. Sometimes people don't want to take it. And from there, 17 were referred to the Turnabout program, and then the other 13 were referred to two other programs. One, you're familiar with Thunderwing, the Alliance approach, where we actually have that program, again, reach out to the family. And then lastly, we have the GAIN program, which is another provincially funded program, the gang program that also structures different types of programs for kids to try and keep them out of issues. And then lastly, we have the education component. This year we've done four community forums, all in each specific district, where we've invited members of the community. We had the cadets do flyer drops. We had a fair amount of media attention. We invite the community out. We bring gang experts out there. We bring the community together to talk about the dangers of gangs and really put information in their hands, let them answer or ask and answer questions that may come forward to them, and really just try and have an all-encompassing approach. So really, with the time I have here today, I think I've highlighted where we're at, unless anyone had any questions.
Councillor
Eady? Yeah, just a couple. I was going to ask you about GAIN. So you are, that's a Winnipeg network of organizations that work with.
Yes.
So that's the GAIN program, right? So,
yes.
No, that's it. It's really good for prevention stuff. But just one question. The liaison with SPI, I think that's great. A lot of these kids are going to schools where we have school resource officers.
Yes.
Are you engaging them as well?
Yeah, absolutely. I should have, again, if I had more time to get into detail. That is also one of the components of the, I guess, the after-action report. Once we identify, they're also advised of this. I can cite several incidents where the SROs were instrumental in trying to prevent you know, young kids from continuing in their path, and they keep us very much apprised to the details. So that was my error. I should have documented that.
Thanks. I appreciate this.
That's a good one. Okay. Thank you very much.
Okay, so really what I wanted to do is just give you a sense of how we're managing that. So today I had Max just highlight gang suppression, but we've assigned a senior officer to each one of the action items and objectives. And this is kind of the exercise that we go through on a regular basis so that we're aware of the challenges that our members are encountering, that we're aware of you know, what they've done to advance the strategies and what we can look forward to. So each one of the items within the business plan is kind of managed in this fashion. So thank you, Max.
Long range. Okay. So we prepare to move the report. Thank you, Councillor Eadie. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Number 11, Winnipeg Police Board, Rules of Practice and Procedure, Summary of Proposed Revisions.
I'll just move that. This has been discussed online with the members of the board. So if there's any questions about that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Number 12, Use of Force Policy, Consultation Draft.
And so that's on the agenda so that we were able to have delegations come and speak to it?
Okay. And we had the Indigenous Council representatives. Very good. Again, there's still an opportunity if there's any members of the public that are following today's meeting or present. If you have additional feedback to provide, that process is open through Friday of this week. You can find the draft policy if you either Google the police board, it's right on our website, or through winnipeg.ca website. So, okay, somebody care to move that this be received?
Move adjourned.
Hold on. You have to remove the use of force policy first. So, you care
it's
to move
just
down.
For information.
Just for information at this point.
Yeah.
So moved. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. There is a spot, a placeholder here for new business. Any new business to deal with? Here none. Councillor Eadie?
Move adjournment.
So moved. All those in favor? Opposed? Carried. Thank you, everyone. Everybody drive safe, walk safe. It's slippery out there.
Be safe.
Do you think that we could produce these for the chief and his vice chiefs as well?
Oh, that's fine.
These are ours, right?
They are ours.
Yes.
We were going to ask if they were still...